Welcome everyone. Today we're hosting Serhii Mokhniev from CX, MLRO. Plenty, a wealth of experience in compliance. You're an ex-lawyer. Thank you for coming today on Blockchain Rock and for taking the time to do that.
Omri, thank you very much for the invitation. So it's really my pleasure to be here to speak to you because I believe there are many things we can discuss today. Yesterday, let's be honest with all those who view us, we were talking about what we can discuss, but in last 30 minutes, we discussed much more. So I believe that will be quite interesting conversation. I definitely have something to say. And let's see what we can discuss, not only about blockchain, because definitely it's the big issue, the great question, but we still live in people.
Let's start with your background. If you can, please talk a bit about your background, about your story so far. We usually start interviews like that, so I'll give the floor.
It makes a great sense because many people may ask, what this Ukrainian guy do there in Gibraltar working on UK company? So that's the usual question. So the background can be told either in short or long way. What would you prefer?
Long way. We would need a few extra hours.
But nevertheless, so I started as a lawyer in Ukraine. I studied in Ukraine. Then in 2014, on the 8th of August, I first time came to my CXIO office as a lawyer that time. And then I moved to compliance. Now I'm sitting here as a designated MLRO and compliance officer for Gibraltar entity and being also the regulatory affairs counsel for entire CXIO group. So specializing mostly on compliance matters in virtual currencies, blockchain, and also sometimes touching other fintech issues like electronic money, payments, and fintech in general.
Okay, and as an MLRO, what are the main challenges? Actually, before that, if possible, can you tell us a bit about CX.io? It's one of the longest running exchanges, one of the most prominent one. So, yeah, if you could tell us about its story, how it started.
I would say that CX is something that runs through my veins. You can see the company
logo here.
seek it in internet. Yeah, that's the company's logo. This tattoo was made 3 years ago in Odessa. It's on the southern Ukraine, the coastal city. The long story, unfortunately, we don't have so much time, but to anybody who wants to know more, I usually answer these questions quite frankly. So CXIO, first of all, it's a virtual currency exchange, though it started back in 2013 as the provider of GHash.io, the cloud mining service. So then CXIO distributed the units of mining power. Unfortunately, by that time, comparing to what we have now, it wasn't a scam, it was the real mining, baked by real hardware. The mining by that time was completely different than now, but then we decided to shift to a different business model, the fiat-friendly virtual currency exchange. And since then, August. So in August, we started to process fiat transactions for our customers, mostly by payment cards. And to provide the false statements, but I suppose that by that time we was among the first three companies which provided card acceptance for buying virtual currency. Since then, that was 2014 when we launched support of fiat transaction and actually exchange service, we significantly evolved. Now we provide financial instruments. Now our exchange service extended from only Bitcoin trading to about 10 different coins. We not mostly, but exclusively support recognized virtual currencies, which, for example, in the language of the recent FCA policy statement, may be categorized as unregulated tokens. So like Bitcoin, Bitcoin Cash, XRP, Stellar, you know them. Also, we develop internally the identity verification service. So all this stuff. The big thing about CXIO, which I like the most, we're always evolving company. So you always move forward. You never stand on the point. Our CEO always looking for some new opportunities, some new engagements, and it's really exciting. No, that's why I have this.
Yeah.
Yes, because CXO, it's not just the company. It's probably the way of life. And actually, it brought me here to Gibraltar. And that's actually how the Ukrainian guy with Ukrainian legal background appeared in Gibraltar. That's amazing. And actually, that's an amazing place for amazing people.
Let me bring you back to one thing that you said. You mentioned just now the FCA guidelines. Mm-hmm. And I know because we spoke yesterday, as you mentioned at the beginning, that you've been involved in developing, to an extent, these guidelines together with the FCA and I guess together with other stakeholders. I know that you've also been involved in some way in introducing and arguing in favor of crypto assets and the fintech industry at large at the United Nations. So can you tell us a little bit more about your involvement in these different areas and what is your role as an MLRO?
Thank you for this. So I would say that we at CXO really great advocates for the long time for virtual assets, virtual currencies, digital assets, for this new class of assets. Though it's so we evolved and virtual assets evolved too. So if 5 years ago we could speak exclusively about Bitcoin, so the year later in 2014 or 2015 we then could speak about Ethereum. Yes, now we have all these smart contracts. Now we have all these ERC-20 tokens. Now we have ICOs, STOs, EEOs. So we have all this. What have been done? Not only by us, but by many other advocates. We indeed try to engage regulators, engage standard setting bodies like FATF, Financial Action Task Force. You know that, yes, about the United Nations. Next week, I will attend the conference hosted by the United Nations Office of Drugs and Crime in Singapore regarding the virtual currencies and virtual assets. So specifically, we will be talking and participating on the panel discussion together with the big players like Bitfinex, Coinbase, about our KYC systems. That's actually what we built, and I personally participated in building in the position of MLRO and Regulatory Affairs Council.
Which is the main challenge, right? Because just to explain, KYC and AML represent the biggest, I'd say, legal challenge to crypto asset, correct? In the eyes of the regulator, because there are concerns that these assets could be used to launder money, to finance terrorist activity, or is that not the case?
You know, I don't want to be blatant, but I would say that saying that AML and CTF is the biggest problem of virtual assets is slightly outdated.
Okay.
So 3 years ago, we could say that's a big issue. Now it's still the big issue, but we have many others big issue like cybersecurity, funds protection, compliance handling and customer support. All this stuff, which is usually covered by financial licensing. So any company who come to this industry should think not only about AML and CFT. So from the position of MLRO, yes, I would say that the most important thing.
Yeah.
No, I don't think that my job is the most important. I believe that it's as important as any other parts of the business. You should think about your clients. You shouldn't think only about how to collect all their data, how to process it, how to report suspicious activity, so it's quite important. But you should think about all this stuff. By the way, so now we deal with the recently issued FATF guidance on the risk-based approach to virtual currency, issued on the 21st of June. So now we are living in the new period of life for all digital assets industry, and particularly defined by this guidance, so-called VASPs, virtual asset service providers. We have the new set of rules. We have this new introduced funds travel rule, which is not a new for conventional financial system. So they deal with this for almost two decades.
Could you expand on that? What is that exactly?
In simple words, I'm a WASP and you're a WASP. I'm virtual currency exchange, you're the hosted wallet. When my customer sends funds, virtual funds to you on chain through blockchain, he initiated the transaction on our platform, we execute it and send funds to you. And we have to accompany the transaction with a certain data, both on originator and beneficiary. So let's say the customer sends funds not to his wallet, but to the wallet of the third party, or even on his own, but hosted by you. So we have to accompany this transaction with his name, his date of birth, his address, his personal ID data.
Where exactly are you recording this data? Because I guess it's not going on the blockchain, correct? Like that's, it's not part of the smart contract.
That's what we asked during the public consultation hosted by FATF in May this year in Vienna. So we also asked where we should, how we should transfer the data. And we were answered, well, you will definitely find a way. You're a fintech. You're a savvy guy.
So basically, they expose you to more compliance because you'll have to comply with all of the GDPR if you operate, if you provide services in Europe, correct?
Yes. So that's a dual sharp blade. So on the one hand, now, especially in the European Union, we have the GDPR.
Yeah.
On the other hand, we have this newly established fund transfer rule for virtual currencies. So
do you think there is a scope for a new smart coin, for a new coin, maybe to provide for...
Let's say FATF compliant coin.
Yeah, that could be like a marketable.
I believe that there is always a place for some new coin.
Yeah.
Every time. But for one reason or another, they usually don't succeed. So what we are talking now in our compliance circles, we are looking for the solution. So the idea that in 1 year after the guidance was adopted, so that will be 21st of June of 2020, FATF will review the progress on this, so how countries succeeded in putting everything into compliance, how private sector succeeded in compliance with these new requirements. Probably there will be no penalties. At least I hope so, because the 1 year is not enough to adapt and especially to bring something that initially wasn't intended to this. It was just about peer-to-peer digital cash transactions.
Especially without any form of guidance or with, let's say, with little guidance, it would be a bit disproportionate.
Probably the new guidance is not required because we now have the guidance.
Yeah.
So guidance on guidance, and then also some advisory on guidance, and then the recommendation on advisory, which was on guidance on guidance. No, so there should be the one document which explains everything.
Yeah.
I know, and at least I would like to think that I know what they try to do. They try to do the round figure into the circle hole. You know this game for children when you need to put triangles in rounds. Yeah. Yes, all this stuff. I suppose that after some time we'll find the real working solution somewhere in the middle, because definitely there will be some shortcomings in complying with this recommendation in its current edit. So what the reason? They put something that work for traditional finance, especially now. So this funds travel rule now works due to SWIFT protocol, the mass engine system. By the way, I made a discovery for my own. Did you know that SWIFT is a non-commercial organization? It's actually a non-for-profit organization.
So that it's going to be like Libra, like the association.
SWIFT itself is the association of financial institutions. So it's maintained from contributions of the members. And that's fine. That's one of the way which we now consider for complying with the recommendation to establish some kind of non-for-profit organization, which will maintain the protocol. But just consider. So we have the blockchain protocol, which can transfer value on its own, because SWIFT, for example, doesn't transfer the value. And then we have another protocol off-chain, but which works parallel to this. Is it viable? Is it feasible? I do not know. Probably no, but maybe yes. Yes, if we would put it on the rules which worked and still work for traditional finance. But maybe there is a reason somewhere which will be more feasible, more technically grounded. But let's see. It's too early to say. We are now just in the process of discussion.
And what about the FCA? Going back to the other side of this, the question, what was your contribution? What type of contribution has the FCA requested from you guys, as well as from, you know, the other stakeholders that have assisted them in developing these guidelines?
If FCA would see this, I would like to say I like FCA.
Yes, the camera is there.
I definitely. I don't watch to anybody else. But and that's not a joke. Why? Because I really appreciate the approach of the FCA to new technologies, to virtual, say in the FCA consultation paper and the final guidance, crypto assets. So they took quite meaningful, quite grounded approach. They didn't make any preliminary statements, decisions. They didn't impose any bans on this.
So they left all doors open, I
guess. Yes. So they launched the consultation back in January 2019. Mm-hmm. It was completely transparent. All participants were encouraged to contribute this. After that, they launched few roundtables regarding different issues. Fifth AMLD, regulatory perimeter, different type of tokens. Then they put everything together. It took some time, of course, so the consultations were closed in April. And on 31st of July, they finally issued the policy statement on crypto assets. As you mentioned, we as the company, CXIO,
yeah,
and as the part of Crypto UK, which is a trade association of UK virtual currency businesses, contributed to this consultation. Mostly we were agreed with the then position of FCA, which they communicated through the consultation paper. Only the one thing we were asked for is to slightly change the taxonomy of crypto assets. So by that time, they divided all tokens into three groups. Exchange tokens, which are most famous digital assets like Bitcoin, Litecoin, Bitcoin Cash, all these. Security tokens, you know what it's about.
Yeah.
And utility tokens. Now they changed the taxonomy to e-money tokens. So when the token meets the definition of e-money, just like it put in the FCA handbook. Security tokens and unregulated tokens. And this category of e-money tokens, that's what we were asking for, because we believe that this will give the new push for development on future of payments and future of e-money. Because if the company, if the issuer want to leverage its product, its electronic money by DLT, definitely it should be recognized as e-money, and this company should have no issues with the FCA to recognize its product as the e-money and get the authorization.
What about, would Bitcoin, for example, fall within this definition?
For now, it's defined as unregulated token. In the final in the policy statement, they expressly name it in the category of unregulated tokens. Okay. So, of course, they provide the definition of unregulated tokens and the characteristics. Yes. So, for example, those who now have the business of dealing with bitcoins, for example, exclusively bitcoins, they can be they can sleep well and without no worries that sometime they have in near future get the inquiry from the FCA regarding their business model. So they now considering what will be the future of the category of unregulated tokens. Because by all means, Bitcoin remains quite speculative and quite volatile instrument. Yeah. And even if we talk about the pure Bitcoin transaction, not about, for example, derivatives only, like contract for difference, futures, options,
yeah,
especially which usually trade on leverage, even with Bitcoin, you can lose, especially when you're not a sophisticated trader, very quick. So there might be some additional layer of customer protection, clients protection for those who trade, who deal with unregulated tokens, but that's something for future considerations.
I see. I know you've also been involved with Europol. Can you talk to us about it a little bit?
Yeah, the public information, because we publicly participated in two conferences hosted by Europol in The Hague, Netherlands, in 2019 and just 2 months ago, this year. So about 2 years ago, I approached the Europol saying that, hello guys, we are here. We suppose that we may have some ideas on how we can help you and help you to help crypto industry.
Help you, help us.
Yes, to proliferate and to stay on the good stance with regulators, because it's still quite important to the industry. Because what we do usually, we try to say that virtual currency is not about crooks, it's not about criminals.
Yeah.
Because 99.99% of customers are either early adopters, are people acting on the good faith, law-abiding people, they just either are interested in virtual currency or use it as the payment instrument, as speculative interest, or they're just curious. But there is always a small portion of bad actors who put the shadow on our industry.
Yeah.
And because of them, we have all these funds travel rules, not only in crypto.
Yeah, negative publicity.
Yeah, absolutely right.
So you contact them out of the blue. You just approach them
just
straight.
That was just the cold mailing. So I just wrote to the general address. And in few days, I received the response from Jarek. Jarek Jakubsek, he's a strategic analyst. By the way, Jarek, if you see this, hello. He one of the most amazing person I ever met. So he and his colleague, Patrice, they've now for 6 years, they host the conferences in the Europol headquarters. They bring together law enforcement agencies and virtual currency businesses to talk about the mutual issues. So how we can get rid of all those bad actors, mm-hmm, how in return they can succeed in their investigations, how they actually can benefit from blockchain, from its transparency, from its traceability. And last year we were invited to speak about our company, to present us, to speak with about 300 market representatives and mostly law enforcement agents from all over the world. So not only from European Union, but from many other countries, even from Ukraine, my home country. So the representatives of the office of the prosecutor general were also there. And I, for the first time in my life, I had the chance to speak with the cybersecurity concerned guys from our office of the prosecutor general in the Netherlands, not in Ukraine. That was the great opportunity. After that, we had numerous contacts, great networking. So that's all because of the Jarek and Patrice efforts. And of course, the Europol management. I don't know how they call this. We, in private sector, we call this management. You know what I mean.
Yeah.
So this year, we came again. After this conference, I actually, having the many inputs from all participants, wrote the article for the CoinDesk about the funds travel rule. So this a great hub of opinion exchange for some new ideas, and I really like it. How it helps in practice? Just a simple case. About 4 months ago, maybe more, 6 months we received the inquiry from the law enforcement agency in Germany asking us about information one of our customers and request to freeze the account. It was involved in fraud scheme amounting to 100,000 euros. In virtual currency space, you have to act quickly because, you know, it's all about speed. Somebody funds your account for this amount, then buy crypto with Revolut to nowhere, and that's it. We were helped by Europol to verify the genuinity of this request just in minutes. And yes, we did as requested, and we helped some person in Germany to save 100,000 of his savings. That's how it worked. So it worked in practice. And
but is this cooperation desirable for the end customer, let's say? Like, is there any concern about, you know, your privacy, about this cooperation, you know, between the private sector and law enforcement? Of course, in this case, it is desirable. But let's assume, for example, that was not, you know, a founded claim or...
I see.
Do you see any problem arising from this, you know, cooperation between private and public?
The data privacy is one of the freedoms of European Union. Yeah. And Europol, as the European Union's body, they also honor privacy. So it's in the core, or let's say under their skin. And they respect it. They know how they should act. And they always act in the lawful way.
In the interest of these
Yes,
rights.
Absolutely. Okay. So they're among those who always looking to find the balance between the interest of individuals, their privacy, and the interest of the public.
Just to play devil's advocate, of course, I agree with you, this is a beneficial aspect and development. But, you know, it seems that Bitcoin, at least, was developed because of, you know, the lack of trust in public institution and in how people that had that ability balanced, you know, the interest of many against the interest of a few and so on. And now it seems that actually... what's being associated to the fintech industry is always more involvement from these institutions, from these public bodies that perhaps have not, if not failed, but contributed to what happened in 2008, you know, to the US crisis. I'm just playing devil advocate. I'm probably very wrong, but I just want to see
You're completely right. So if we will check the Bitcoin white paper, yes, it's just a peer-to-peer digital cash payment system.
Yeah.
It's a quotation with slight deviation, but nevertheless, I communicated the idea. But it never was about crooks, about bad actors, about fraudsters. It was never about it. It was just to bring the... I'm not sure even if we could say here about faster payments. Because, for example, there are more sufficient payment system for now, because, for example, Visa and MasterCard systems can process more transactions at the one period of time in less time. But it's more about peer-to-peer transactions.
Decentralizing, and it's about
decentralization,
that,
about peer-to-peer value transfer. And it still remains so. But in the cases when you're when you engage one company which deals with this or another for some reason.
Yep.
Because you want to trade on centralized exchange. For example, you want to exchange your mining proceeds to fiat currency. You have to deal with them. And yes, they are acting as the gatekeepers to fiat world. Then you have to face with some rules which were imposed to fiat world. So you always can remain in peer-to-peer
the crypto
world.
Domain. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely right. So that's a matter of choice. You can stay there, or if you need something more, you can go there.
But that's for now, right? Because, like, if you look, for example, at a jurisdiction like Gibraltar, and I'm mentioning Gibraltar because I know that you've recently secured the DLT provider license, you have to, you know, come face to face with some rule and a level of compliance which is typical of a financial services provider, because the jurisdiction started to provide regulatory coverage, in this case for like blockchain and DLT businesses dealing with operating blockchain and DLT as part of their offering. So I think this is just temporary, this ability to remain completely off the grid, or if not off the grid, you know, within the domain that is not regulated.
Once again, it depends. So probably at any point of time, I hope so, nobody will regulate Bitcoin blockchain at all, because it's just like to regulate internet. You can regulate internet service providers, and in many jurisdictions they are actually regulated. But not the internet itself. The same to Bitcoin blockchain and any other permissionless blockchains.
So the use, but not the technology itself.
Yes, absolutely right. So it's not about technology, because regulation is technology natural. And nobody regulate, I don't know, some beings in terms of green energy, but they may regulate the tariffs for green energy. Yeah. So, and thank you for mentioning actually our newly acquired DLT license. So it indeed took us some time to secure the license. Yes, with the DLT provider license, but we finally made this. And thank you to the Gibraltar Financial Services Commission, because they helped us a lot to go through all these requirements, to understand them. Thank you for their guidelines. I would say that we are not a newcomers to the regulatory in case of virtual currencies, because, for example, in the United States, we are regulated since 2015, when we registered as the money services business. But Gibraltar's framework, it's much more comprehensive than just registration for AML purposes. I'm not sure whether we talked about this yesterday or on the record, that there are two approaches to the regulation for now. Only AML coverage and the full licensing, just like it works for electronic money institutions, payment institutions, banks, insurance companies, etc. So Gibraltar now provides the full coverage, which deals with cybersecurity, funds protection, risk management, fitness and properness of key persons, and of course, financial crime. What's the benefit for us in this case? The benefit is that now we can say to our customers and our partners that, look, we are not the self-regulated company as we were before, because why I said it, we are newcomers not only to AML, we are also not a newcomers to all other aspects. So we applied the necessary IT security measures, cyber security, fund protectors, etc. But now we are confirmed this. Oh, sorry, I do not want to touch the mic. It's quite sensitive, I know. Now we are oversighted, and the regulator, the Gibraltar regulator, confirmed that we are good enough to have the license, and now our customers, for example, can sleep knowing
find comfort in that.
Yeah, so their funds are protected, both crypto and fiat. Our partners know that we apply the highest standards of financial crime prevention. It's quite important for our, for example, banking partners, our other financial institutions, which we use to facilitate the fiat transactions. So now you can rest assured that everything will be fine. It took really some time, but I would say that we became much smarter guys after this. I would say that now any license probably would be like a piece of cake. After we worked with the guys from GFSC, I would really say thank you to DLT team and entire GFSC for giving us the chance to represent our business and demonstrate that we are, have sufficient processes.
Yeah, I'd say that we can probably wrap up. We spoke about your story. We spoke about CX story. Spoke about your involvement, guys, with the Financial Task Force, Europol, with the FCA guidelines, and now also with about like in the benefits of securing the DLT license. So, Sergio, thank you again so much for coming, and we hope to have you soon again.
Hope so. So I'll be here as a designated MLRO of CXAO.
So we for sure have you again. Thank you very much, everyone.